Black math. Give me some math and I'll give you some flack. Black math. Okay. 67. Oh, lab. Wants to be the lab. Okay, introduction to transformations. All right, so transformations are, you guys probably remember this from pre-algebra and algebra or whatever, but you know how you can rotate something, you can flip it, you can, what's the other one? Rotate, flip, and then slide it back and forth, okay? So here's the deal. An isometry, if you want to write this down, you can. This guy here, it's a transformation that does not change the size or shape of a figure. So that is the image of an isometry is congruent. So this is like us flipping it and rotating it a little bit. You see how these two are congruent triangles? So I could literally take it off the page, flip it over and rotate it a little bit and put it right back on to U prime, T prime, V prime. Okay, and so instead of using three different letters to label an isometric figure, we use the same letters and then we put a little apostrophe and we call it prime. So if this is TUV, triangle TUV, then this is triangle T prime, U prime, V prime. Okay? So T corresponds with T prime, U corresponds with U prime, and so on. All right? So let me Okay. So you guys understand what an isometry is? So it's just a transformation that does not change the size. And the image, the resulting image is an isometry of an isometry is congruent to its pre-image. The pre-image would be without the little apostrophes and the image would be with the apostrophes. Okay? So look at this guy. So here's one example of an isometry is a slide, or it's called a translation technically, but that's when you just take a shape and slide it. So see how we just slid it down to the right? So JKLM is J prime, K prime, L prime, M prime, when you just slide it over. Okay, that's called a translation. But you need to know that. You need to know the name is called a translation, okay? Here's another one, a reflection, or basically a flip. We don't call it a flip. That's what they call it on the streets, but not here. This is a reflection. So it's like ABCD is looking in the mirror and this is what he sees. A prime, B prime, C prime, D prime. Okay? So any questions so far? It's pretty straightforward, right? All right, and then there's some more. There's a rotation. That's just finding a point, and it doesn't even have to be a point on the shape and just rotating. So see how right here, this point just rotated all the way over to there. Or actually, it only went from here to here. Okay? So we just rotated it a little bit. Okay? So sometimes you can do multiple ones, but what kind of transformation is this? In example 1A and B, do you see it? You can answer if you want. Is that a translation, rotation, or reflection? Anyone? Yes, Kate.
Rotation. I'll just.
That's right. You were muted, but we're just gonna assume you said the right answer. So this is a reflection. So see how it. So if you rotate it, it's backwards. So it wouldn't be a rotation, but it's a reflection. So it's like we flipped it over, okay? All right, what about this? What kind of transformation is this guy from RST to R prime S prime T prime? Anyone know? No, nobody wants to answer. That's okay. That's a rotation. So see how we're just rotating from here and it goes all the way to here. Okay, it just rotates. All right, and spoiler alert, we've already done two out of the three. So the third one, this is just a translation. A translation is a slide. So it just goes up from here, right? It goes, oops. It just slides that way. That's it. That's all it does. So that's a translation. Okay?
How many transformations are there? Three or two?
Right now there's three. Now there's another one. It's not an isometric transformation, but it's another transformation. It's called dilation. So it just expands. It just gets bigger. But right now there's only three. Now there's different words for them, but the official words are translation, which is when you slide it. Rotation, which is just picking a point. Like in this case, it rotates around point R. All right. And then the other one is a reflection when you flip it. Okay. So that for every reflection, there has to be an axis. There has to be a line of reflection. And for every rotation, there has to be a point of rotation. Okay. But translation, you just slide it, but you can't rotate it or flip it in any way. You just slide it, but you can combine different transformations. Okay. So in this case, I want to try to reconstruct. So I'm going to rotate this. Let's try to do that. So basically, this LJ has to go right here. So let's say that is LJ. So this would be my J prime. Okay. And then this is also L prime is L because it rotates around L. All right, and then this guy needs to go this way. So this is gonna be a little tricky. So I'm gonna do LM next, and I have to go that much. So let's see here. Maybe it's, since I know that, well, they're not quite parallel. Let's see here. Maybe it goes to like right there. So LM. I'm gonna call that M prime. All right, and then let's see. This JN looks like it's right there. So let's call that N prime. And that looks pretty good. So on a test, if you're asked to do this, you just kind of have to do it like that, where you can use a straight edge if you want, but I want to know that you know how to do this. So if you can just show me the gist of it, then I'll give you credit for it. And then your homework, same kind of thing. Okay. So I was close, but not quite. All right, let's translate this that far. So this little capital P, let's see if we can translate this. So all, remember, we're not rotating it. So all these lines are still gonna be parallel. So this line's gonna be parallel to the one before it. It goes up and to the right. So that's the gist, right? I made that a little bit too big, but that works. So far, so good. You guys getting this? Easy stuff, right? So now we're going to reflect across FG. So this is our mirror, right? So this is where we're flipping it across. So then it looks like this. We'll see how that makes sense. So that what makes it distinguishable and not just a translation is that this H isn't in the middle. If this H was in the middle, then the reflection would look just like the transformation or translation, right? Because you could just slide it to the right, but it's not a translation, you have to flip it. So see how this H is a little bit closer to FG and this H is a little bit closer to FG, okay? So, and I'm gonna look for that if you're being tested on something like that. So if this was like, so if this was like what you're trying to reflect over this line here, then you got to make sure that Everything is the mirror image. Oops. It's oogly, but it's okay. All right. Okay. So, this is just real life application, which la-di-da. All right. So let's move on to 68. So this is the way that we do geometry class from home. It's kind of, we're limited to just showing you what we're doing and not reiterating stuff. Sometimes it's better to reiterate, and that's what I do in class. But this is me just like showing you pictures and writing on the pictures a little bit. So hopefully it makes sense. But again, this stuff is pretty easy because you've done it before, but you're just moving stuff around. That's okay. All right. Now we get into trigonometry. I think we started talking about trigonometry. Did we talk about trigonometry at all yet? Trigonometric ratios, trigonometric functions. It's really fun to say. So trigonometric ratios are basically, in a right triangle, there's a relationship between the sides, okay? Based on the angles in the triangle or the side lengths, okay? So here's some ratios, and some of you have heard this little saying here, but this is SOHCAHTOA. Okay. SOHCAHTOA is just an acronym. So sine of an angle, and we'll talk about that in a second. Sine of A would be opposite over hypotenuse. So if, for example, if this was A, B, C, so this angle here, opposite of A would be over here, across the pond. All right? And then the hypotenuse is always the hypotenuse. That's never going to change. There's the hypotenuse. But there's a third side in a right triangle. In trigonometry, there are three sides. There's the opposite, there's the adjacent, and there's the hypotenuse. Okay? So this is the adjacent side. Okay? That looks terrible. But it's that word right there. So now, the adjacent and the opposite sides change based on what angle you're talking about. This is called the opposite side because it's opposite of angle A. All right. So this would be in a triangle. If I were to draw a triangle here, and let's say this is like a 3-4-5 triangle. So in this case, if this was A, B, and C, so the sine of this A would be 3/5, right? Because opposite of A is 3, and then the hypotenuse is 5, so that 5 doesn't change, okay? So if I wanted to do the cosine of A, what would the cosine of A be? Well, let's see, adjacent would be this 4. So adjacent to A would be the one that's touching A. So the angle A here, see, 4 is one of the sides. So basically the adjacent angle is the leg or the side of the angle that's not the hypotenuse. So this is the side of angle that's not the hypotenuse. Okay, so you got two sides of the angle A, right? So 5 is the hypotenuse, so the other one is 4. So that's the adjacent. So this would be 4/hypotenuse, which is 5. Okay, now this will come in handy. You'll see why this is important in a second. But this is true for every right triangle where like A is, like maybe A is like 30 something degrees. Maybe it's like 40 degrees or something. So for every right triangle, that ratio is going to be the same. So it could be 6/10 or 9/15, but that ratio is going to be the same based on this angle, okay? So in this case, opposite over adjacent So that would, opposite of A is 3, and adjacent to A is 4. So it's basically a leg over a leg. All right, so let's do some examples here. So I want to do the sine of S. Sine of angle S equals, all right, well, here's S. So what's opposite of S? What small lowercase letter is opposite of angle S? You guys know?
There's T? Is it T, or is it, or am I going the wrong way?
So you're looking for a side. What side, not what angle, but what side is opposite of S? Tanner answered. Do you guys see that? Or is that just to me? Oh, that's just to me. Okay, so yeah. So opposite of angle S, look across the pond from S. Where is it? It's right here. That's A. And then opposite over hypotenuse. So let's just write that out first. Op over hype. So opposite of S is A. And what's the hypotenuse of the triangle? Anybody know? There it is. Tanner knows it. So the hypotenuse will never change. It's basically the longest side. It's C, right? Boom, boom, boom. Okay. So that's where they get A over C, and the sine of T would be opposite of T, which is B over that same hypotenuse, B over C. Okay, so let's try some examples here. Let's see, give the sine, cosine, and tangent of G, okay? No problem. Well, first of all, can you guys figure out what this third side is? How would you figure out that third side? Does anyone know? You could use the Pythagorean theorem, or you could recognize that this sucker is a Pythagorean triple. So 3 squared plus 4 squared equals 5 squared, right? So good job. So now we have all the sides. Now we can write out our ratios. Okay, sine, let's see, let's do this. SOHCAHTOA. Sine equals opposite over hypotenuse. Cosine equals adjacent over hypotenuse. And TOA, tangent equals opposite over adjacent. Okay, so the sine of G is op over hype. What's opposite of G? What side is opposite of G? Okay, Tanner's got it. See that? So look across the pond. Here's G. What does G see across the pond? That's opposite of G, that's 3. And the hypotenuse doesn't change. The hypotenuse is always opposite the right angle, so that's 5. Okay, now the cosine of G is adjacent over hypotenuse. So what's adjacent to G? Well, which side is not the hypotenuse? Which side of this angle G is not the hypotenuse? Well, 5 is the hypotenuse, so 4 is the adjacent side over the hypotenuse, which is 5. Okay, and then tan of G is opposite over adjacent. So that equals 3 over 4. 3, because you already figured out what the opposite and adjacent are, 3 and 4. So opposite over adjacent is 3 over 4. Okay, now these change because if you're talking about another, like if this was H over here, let's say this is point H, Okay. So the sine of H, let's do that in a different color. So let's say this was H. So the sine of H, what's opposite of H? Well, this is the angle, right? This is the angle H. Opposite of H is 4. And the hypotenuse never changes. It's 5. So the opposite and adjacent are relative to what angle you're talking about, okay? But the hypotenuse never changes. And then the cosine of H is adjacent over hypotenuse, right? What's adjacent to H? Well, what side is not the hypotenuse is 3 over hypotenuse, which is 5. So do you guys notice that when you're talking about the other angle, the sine and cosines flop? Okay. So now if you're talking about the other angle, the adjacent one is now the opposite one, and the opposite one is now the adjacent one. So these are going to be the same answers, but they're flopped. Okay. All right, now this is where it gets down to the nitty gritty. Cosine of 72 degrees equals 31. Well, how do you know? Well, you gotta use your calculator. Look at this. I'm gonna share my calculator here. Now this is just, if you were gonna use an iPhone, then what you do is you take the iPhone and you flip it on its side, okay? So all you have to do here is just type in 72 and then hit cosine. Oops, it's on the different one. So then you just hit, I don't want to do the sine. So I'm going to do 72 and then I'm going to hit cosine. Now, if you are on a normal, nice scientific calculator or with trig functions, you would just spell it out exactly what you see on there. So you would see cosine 72, enter, and you're done. But on an iPhone, you have to flip it sideways. You have to put the number first and then flip it. So this is 0.331 because you round to the nearest hundredth, right? Okay, so let's go back to our lesson here. Okay. So on a calculator, if you do sine of 30, that's 0.5, all you do is type that into the calculator, okay? All right, so this is where it gets down to why these things are important, okay? So let's just move in here, and I want to show you how to find E. Okay, well, how do we find E? Well, let's see if we can figure this out. So if I were to write, let's say this is A. Okay, so the sine of A, let's go back. We don't need A. So here's our 72 degree angle. So if that's 72, we don't really need this right now, but we could say this is 18 degrees because they both all have to add up to 180, right? So if I took this and I said, okay, well, if I did tangent of 72, remember tangent is opposite over adjacent, right? Well, what's opposite of that 72 degree angle? What's opposite of this? Tan of 72 equals, well, that's E, right? And that's what we're trying to find. And then over adjacent, which is 13. Okay, so see how I just wrote out that trigonometric ratio there? All I did was I found the tangent. Now, I could have found the sine. Well, sine would say E over this, but they don't give us the hypotenuse. So if they don't give us the hypotenuse, then we can't really use the sine or cosine function because sine is opposite over hypotenuse, which we don't have, and cosine is adjacent over hypotenuse, which we don't have, okay? But we do have the opposite and adjacent side to that 72 degree angle. So we can use our tangent function, okay? Now, here's the cool thing. is if I wanted to solve for E, how do I solve for E algebraically? How do I get that E by itself? What do I need to do? How do I get rid of that 13? Well, to get rid of something in an algebraic equation, you do the opposite operation. So if it's been being divided, we're going to multiply by 13 on both sides. Whatever you do to one side, you do the other. So E equals 13 times the tangent of 72. Well, guess what? We know how to find the tangent of 72. Okay, so we just take out our calculator and we do this. So we're going to find, so on your, what is happening? So on your calculator, on your trigonometric calculator, you can just say, you can type the 30. Was it 30? Hold on. 13 times tangent of 72, all in your calculator, and it works fine. But if you're using your iPhone, you have to find the tangent of 72 first. So 72 tangent. And then we're going to multiply. So that's 3.08-ish. But leave it like that and just multiply by 13. And you get 40.01. Okay. So let's go back to sharing this screen. So this was ended up being 13 times, what is it, 30 point something? I don't remember. But basically, let me just get that number real quick. So you don't have to do it this way because you can just do it all in one step and that's totally fine. So this is 13 times 3.08-ish equals E. So E ends up being 40.01, whatever that is. And does it look like 40? Yeah, it looks like it could be, like, because 13 times 3 is 39. So that could be like three times as long. So all we did was write out our trigonometric ratio and we just solved for our unknown. We got E by itself. And this is all just a constant. Tangent of 32 is a number that we can use in our equation. Okay? So this is what they did. Let's zoom out a little bit. Okay? So this is where it comes down to why this is important. Because in the past, the only way to figure out what another side in a right triangle was the Pythagorean theorem. But you need two sides to figure out the third side in a right triangle, right? Using the Pythagorean theorem. But now look, we only have one side, but we have one angle. If you're given an angle and one side in a right triangle, you can figure out the other two sides. This is why trigonometry is important. Where it's impossible to figure that out up until now, unless you know trigonometry. Okay, so see if you can do this one. This one's a little bit trickier because it ends up being, the X is on the bottom, but let's see. If we're talking about 32 degrees, then what is the 8 and what is the X? Is that opposite, adjacent, or hypotenuse? What's the 8? You guys know? What's the 8 relative to 32? Is that opposite, adjacent, or hypotenuse? Okay. You guys see the chat? Tanner answered. That's opposite. So it's across from the 32 degree angle. And what's X? Well, that is the hypotenuse. Okay, so what trig ratio deals with opposite and hypotenuse? That would be sine. So sine of 32 degrees equals 8 over X. Okay, so far so good? All right, here's where it gets weird. Is X is on the bottom. So to get X by itself, you have to like multiply by X on both sides and it gets weird. Or you could just go right in and start dealing with that 32 degrees. Let's see here. Let's find the sine of 32 degrees is about 0.53. Okay, so this is 0.53. I did that on a calculator, equals 8 divided by x. Okay, so how do we figure out what x is? 8 divided by something equals that. So you could say 8 divided by 0.53. Or if you solve this algebraically, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to multiply by x. And that will cancel it here, but then I'll have it on this side. So x times, or I could have done it, I could have started with that too. So x times 0.53 equals 8. So now how do you solve for x? You divide by 0.53. Okay, so I'm going to do that on my calculator. So 8 divided by 0.53 is 15.09-ish. Okay, so x equals approximately 15.09-ish, which kind of makes sense. If this is 8, that's 15. That makes sense. Okay, so here's what I would rather you do, though. I'd rather you get x by itself first and then do the math. Because if you do the math, you don't have to round or do anything like that. So this is 8 over x. So what I'm going to do first is I'm going to get x by itself first. So x times sine of 32 degrees. Okay. So now all you have to do is divide by the sine of 32. To get x by itself. So x equals on your calculator 8 divided by parentheses sine of 32. You can do that on your calculator. And that works. Okay, so if I use my calculator, I'm going to show you how to do it on an iPhone. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to. Clear that out. So I'm going to go 8 divided by, and then I'm going to do this parenthesis here, blip, 32 sine, other parenthesis, blip, equals. Okay, so see how we didn't have to round anything? So this is the most exact answer you can have right here, 15.09. And actually, that changes our answer. We got 15.09, but now that 6 tells us to go to 15.10. So the more exact answer would be 15.10. Okay? So that's using trigonometry. This is going to take some practice, so don't stress about it. You guys are going to do great. If you get stuck, use that solutions manual to help you with these problems, but practice makes perfect. So if it's still a little cloudy, it probably should be, but that's why we do the homework, to practice these concepts. So please do the homework and get some practice in this. Okay, so any questions before we sign off?
I have a stupid one.
Okay, remember, every question is a stupid question, so you don't have to clarify that. What's your stupid question?
Is there any trick for doing the sine, cosine, and tangent functions in your head?
No. You have to know. You have to use a calculator, because you can't memorize it. There's a few that you can memorize. Like, you remember those 30-60 right triangles? Those are easy to memorize because you know what those are. It's opposite over that. So it's like radical 3 over 2 or things like that. Okay. But you have to, back in my day, I wasn't able to use a calculator. I couldn't do trig functions on a calculator. I had a chart of all the different degrees, 43.1 degrees, 43.2 degrees, 43.3. And it said the sine, had a column for sine, cosine, and tangent. That was a pain in the butt. So you have to use your calculator for those functions. But the SOHCAHTOA, to remember the ratios, you can use SOHCAHTOA. So Sine equals opposite over hypotenuse, cosine equals adjacent over hypotenuse, and tangent is opposite over adjacent. Okay? The music just got intense. Any other questions? You guys good? All right.